Hello and welcome to the webinar of HyperMesh and Loadstep Creation in OptiStruct. My name is Marius and I'm going to show you how to use the Altair preprocessor HyperMesh, and I'm also going to show you how to set up a finite element model and how to run your first simulation. If you open HyperWorks, you will see something similar to this. Up here you see the name of your file you're working on. You see the version you're using. I'm using HyperWorks 2022.1. And you see the solver interface you're going to run your finite element model on. So solver for us today is OptiStruct, but there are several other solvers HyperMesh is supporting. Furthermore, in this graphic user interface, you have the menu up here with file, for example, new, open, and so on, save, for example, edit, view, and you have things like geometry, mesh, element, assembly, and so on. If you click through these menus here, you see that this area here is changing. The buttons you see here are the so-called ribbons, and ribbons are used to help you to create your finite element model. Furthermore, you have your working window here. Here is where your finite element model is going to be displayed later on. And if you turn, for example, if your middle mouse button, if you keep it pressed and you turn your mouse, you will see that this coordinate system is turning around. You also can make use of the projection tools here, and this we are going to use a lot today. On the left hand side here, you see the so-called model browser. This model browser helps you to basically helps you to see what you have in your finite element model. So which geometries you have, which elements you have, how many elements you have, for example, how many load cases you have, how many forces you have, and so on and so on. What we are going to do now is we are going to create import a CAD model. So a geometry model. It's done with file import geometry model. And here we are going to choose mounting suspension and click on open. Then this geometry import options window appears, and you just can click on import and leave everything here as default. Then you can see that your CAD appears in this working window, and on the left hand side, instead of a model browser, we have now a part browser. This part browser, we don't need it at the moment, so you can just close it. If we have a closer look at the model browser now, you can see here that we have components. So one component was imported. It's part body 25. If I click here on part body 25, you see here that our geometry is highlighted. I want to rename this this part body 25, I can just click highlight it here in the model browser and click here on name and call it, for example, CAD. Yeah? I also can change the color of this CAD. For example, I can use this blue or something else, yeah, whatever you like. Then I go back here, and then you have to also some other options to choose, which we will discuss later on. Furthermore, you can see that you have 26 geometries in your model. If you don't have these arrows here to open geometry, you can just right click here on in the white area, right click, configure browser, and here you should tick show entities under subfolders, then you also can see which type of geometries you have in your model. Yeah, just click on OK. So we have one solid and 25 surfaces. That means in Hypermesh, it's always the solid imported, and furthermore, it's the bounding surfaces of the solid are also imported. And then we have parts, which we don't have a closer look today. Okay. Now, what do we actually want to do with this geometry model now? We want to create a tetrahedral mesh out of it. That means we want to divide this whole solid into many, many, many small areas, which are called, so, not areas, volumes, which are called finite elements. And we want to create tetrahedral elements. Exactly. After that, we want to apply boundary conditions here and here. So we will treat this part as it is mounted to a wall, and it's mounted usually with bolts, for example. And instead of modeling bolts today, we are just applying a boundary condition here and here. Furthermore, we are going to create a force, a vertical force, which is acting from up here to in direction of this negative z axis. Yeah, so a negative z direction. Then we have to create a material, and then we can calculate this thing here. To create a tetrahedral mesh, or to create mesh in general, we can make use of this mesh menu here. And there you can see, for example, general 2D mesh and tetra hex. So here is 3D mesh, here is 2D mesh. Yeah. Tetrahedral elements are usually 3D mesh. So it's a 3D element as well as a hexahedral element. To actually create a tetrahedral mesh, you can just click here on tetra. And then this new window is opening, and you have the option to choose create or to remesh. We don't have a mesh to remesh, so we just click here on create. We can select here solid, either this solid, or we can switch to surfaces if we have bounding surfaces, or to component, but we will stick with solids, yeah? And then if you click here on mesh, you will see that a tetrahedral mesh is going to be created, yeah? If I click here on escape and we have a closer look at the mesh created, we can do this if we hide the geometry using this this button here. So if you go to the model browser and click here on this geometry symbol with the left mouse button, you can just hide the geometry. Now you can see that the mesh which was created is shown in wireframe. To change this, you can click here on this symbol down here and make just use of this shaded elements with mesh lines. Yeah, and then you can see the 3D elements which were just created. Yeah, you see that, okay, the mesh is there. We have here some, yeah, I would say not nice meshed area, because here we have this this big element, and here in this radius we have two elements, which is usually not enough for a radius like this. Yeah. So later on we were going to change this. We make it in a finer mesh here in this area and this radius to get the stress gradient, which we are going to calculate even better. Yeah. If you want to have a look at the inside of this mesh, we can just make use of this projection here. For example, go here to all and select elements. Just select a few of these elements and click H on your keyboard, or you go right click in this area and say hide. And then if you turn the mesh around, you see that the whole part is filled with tetrahedral elements. Yeah. Perfect. If you want to show all of the elements again, you can just click here on this newly created component. So maybe I should tell you now what a component actually is. A component is just an entity in HyperWorks, which saves geometry and mesh data. It's possible to have geometries and mesh in the same component, but for me, I just like to have it divided. So HyperMesh automatically created us a component for the mesh. It's called Auto, and I just rename it to Tetraeder. And I want to make it current because I'm going to use it later on. So I right-click on this component and then say Make Current. Yeah. Now I want to show all the elements again. It's either done with this mesh symbol. If you double-click on it, you will get all the elements again. Or you can also right-click on it and say Isolate. Then only this component is shown in this graphic area. Now I'm going to choose elements again, choose all the elements here and just hit delete on my keyboard. Then I can show this our geometry again, and then instead of using Tetra mesh now, I'm going to create a 2D mesh. 2D mesh, this new window is going to be opened, and we have the opportunity to click here on create. We want to create a surface mesh. That means I can click here on this surface and I can make use of this menu now. We want an average element size in the radius of 2.5 millimeters, I would say. And so actually it's not necessarily millimeters. It could be meters as well or whatever you want. Yeah, I just say millimeters now because I want to have stress results in megapascal or newton per square millimeter. So I'm going to use the unit system megagrams millimeters seconds. And that's the reason from now on I will talk in millimeters. Yeah. And why 2.5? Let me hit escape here for a second. And I will make use of this measure tool now. Yeah. I can just click here end to end, for example, and then I see that this diagonal or this measurement from this point to this point is 14.14 millimeters. Yeah. That means if I use an element size of around 2.5 millimeters, I can easily fit, let's say, 5 elements inside here. Yeah. Easily. Yeah. Other measurements, you can just click here 27, or you just highlight the line and you see that this length is 150 millimeter. Yeah. If you click here on 27 again, you also see the different directions. Yeah. We have this measurement is only in Y direction and 27 millimeters long. Yeah. But let's go back to meshing now. So that's orientated in a nice way. And we are going back to general 2D mesh. So in these options here, we want to have an element size of 2.5 millimeter. Element type should be outriers. We want second order elements and the rest we can keep as it is for the moment. You click here on this surface and click on mesh. Then you can see that HyperMesh puts 6 elements at this edge, 6 elements at this edge, and 30 elements at these two edges. This, if you click on Escape, you can easily see that this is way finer model than before, yeah. And if you make use of this tetraeder option now, and use the solid again and average size, we can switch to 5 and element order second. And for the moment, this should be it, yeah? If you click here on mesh now, you will see the following. You will see that this surface mesh we have created before is taken into consideration. And if I hide the geometry, you can see it really easy that the bigger, the coarser elements are connected now to the surface elements we have created before. So here we have a nice area now with nice elements to catch the gradient, the stress gradient, for example, later on in a good way. Yeah. Now it's important to just delete this 2D surface because we don't need it anymore. To do that, you can click here on elements again. So if you hit E on your keyboard, it also changes here from all to elements. And if you click then, if you hide tetraeder, the mesh is tetraeder, you can just select the elements of the component CAD and hit delete on your keyboard. And then you only have tetraeder elements left. Let's look at the inside again. We click here again, elements. Just do this and hit on H on your keyboard. And then you can have a look at the inside. Perfect, yeah? We have a coarse mesh here. We have a more or less fine mesh here, where we expect the highest stress gradient in this direction because we apply a force here. We will get bending stresses here. And these stresses will look, the stress gradient will look here inside the radius. Yeah. So that's the reason why we need a fine discretization here. But if you look at the part, it would be actually nice to have a symmetric mesh so that we have that when we do this element split, that it's not like this. So it should be more or less straight here. I hope you understand. I will just show you. We are going to split this the solid in the middle and only mesh one half of it, and then reflect the other, reflect the elements to the other half, yeah? And this way we have a complete symmetric model. There are also cases you only model a half model and put symmetric boundary conditions if you just are interested in in-plane results, yeah? For example, this bending, what we are going to look at could also be a symmetric boundary condition. If you just model one half of this part, put symmetric boundary condition in this plane here, apply half of the really acting force here, and then you will get the same results. But for now, we are going to delete this mesh here again. Elements delete and show the solid again, yeah? To split the solid in half now, we can make use of this geometry menu and say we want to split. It's here the split ribbon. We want to split with a plane. We have to select a target. Our target is a solid. The solid here, a tool we have to select. We can go here to this endpoint. And then you have to define the normal vector of your splitting plane. We want to split with the YZ plane. So the normal vector of the YZ plane is the X axis. So it's 100. And if you hit on split, you will see that your model was splitted. Yeah, you can hit escape and just delete half of this model. Yeah, this is done by solids. If you choose solids here and hit delete on your keyboard, you will be asked if the associated surfaces should also be deleted. I click yes, please delete them and say delete. And then you can see that only half of the model is there. And if you do this, like only show this half of show geometry, You see that really only half of our original CAD is here in our model. Good, let's 2D mesh this area again. This radius, we are going to back to mesh. It's here, general 2D mesh. The criteria we have chosen before are still there. So we can just click here on the surface and say mesh. Yeah, it was now 5 millimeters. So we can also play with these numbers here. If I click here and here on the 3, for example, and put it back to 6 to get my element size of around 2.5 millimeters again. And if I click here on the 2.8 and put here, for example, let's say 14. Then you can see that I also can adjust the mesh which was created here. Yeah. Click Escape, and now we have this 2D mesh here. I create the 3D tetra mesh again by using the solid. We want an element size of 5 millimeters. Let's check the properties again here. We want second order elements. Now we can also choose curvature-based refinement. That means in areas like this, where the curvature of the geometry is high, we will have automatic refinement in hypermesh. Exactly, the rest can stay like it is for now, and we can click on mesh again, and you will see that now we have a nice mesh again here in this area, and this is what I meant before, that our tetrahedrons are not pointing out of this symmetrical plane. They are really on the symmetric plane. I'm going to delete the 2D mesh again. Say, choose here elements and delete 2D mesh. And like this, and show my tetrahedral mesh alone. Now, since I want to show you one load case today, not only the vertical force, I also would like to show you how to calculate eigenmodes and eigenfrequency. I would like to have a full model and not a half model. As I stated before, if you just want to have the load case with this vertical force, we could apply now a symmetric boundary condition in this plane here and apply the force and put boundary conditions here and calculate. But since I want to show you eigenfrequencies as well, I would like to model the full part in order to not to get every eigenmode of this part. Because if you only have a half model, you miss several eigenmodes because of the boundary condition in the symmetric plane here. To reflect the elements now, you can make use of this here, of this transformation tool. If you open this by just clicking here on transformation tool, you can see here that you are asked which action you want to have. You can translate or you can reflect. Then what do you want to reflect? Elements. We just choose the elements here. Say okay. We want destination component. Now we want the original collector. Direction is here. We have to say which plane should be the mirror plane. And this is again done with the normal vector. And this is for us again. Mirror plane is YZ axis and the normal vector is the X axis. Yeah. So I just click here 100. Base node, which node is on this plane? I can just click on any node here in this symmetric plane, hit OK, and that was basically it. If I hit apply, you see that we have a full model again. Perfect. Now you have to, if you highlight this, you see a line in between the two parts basically. Yeah, this is because we have reflected the elements, yes, but we don't have any connection between the elements on this side and on this side. To merge these elements again, we go here to validate menu, and click here on the three edges ribbon. Here you can see that now this panel was opened. So maybe I should explain this now. Hypermesh is at the moment still divided in ribbons and panels. These panels is Hypermesh history. I think 4 or 5 years ago, everything was still done with these panels down here. And at the moment, we are working on a solution to include everything what could be done with these panels down here, with these ribbons, just to make it more intuitive and faster, to create a faster workflow. But yeah, for now we have still some functions like this three edges functions in these panels. Here you can switch to elements now, select these elements and leave this as default and just click on preview elements. Preview equivalence, sorry. What you can see here now is maybe I use the transparent mode for elements, and you can see here that basically every node in the symmetric plane was highlighted. This is because of the following. We have basically, maybe I'll explain it like this. We have one element here on this side. If I choose elements here, we have this element and this element, for example. I select both and right click and say isolate. And I only have those two elements here, yeah? So, and these elements are not connected with each other, yeah? So that means we have the nodes here, for example, we have now the top node of this element and the top node of this element. Now, if you make use of this three edges tool and select these two elements and say preview equivalence again, you see that three nodes are going to be equivalent. This is because we have set the tolerance, the searching tolerance, to 0.01 millimeter. That means we have one node of this element here, and from this element, we also have a node here. These two nodes don't have a distance. They are basically on top of each other. That means they are in this tolerance of 0.010. So Hypermesh is recognizing it and is suggesting you to equivalence those two nodes, that you only have one node left up here. One node which belongs to this element and this element. And this is basically how this tool works. If I click here on, double click on this mesh symbol again and say here elements displayed, then all elements here are selected, and if you say preview equivalent, you see that 1,342 nodes were found to be equivalent. If I click on equivalence now, all the nodes in the symmetric plane are going to be equivalent. If I click here on all then again, and here on this mesh, you see that we don't have a splitting line anymore inside this mesh, yeah? That means we have equivalence now, these two sides, and exactly, we have only one mesh, not two separated meshes anymore. Perfect, I close this panel view again, and I'm going to create a material now. To create a material, the best thing to go to the model menu and say here, material. Click on material, and then this window, create material, is going to be opened. Create materials, yeah? We can again give the material a name. I'll call it mud and steel, for example. We can give this material an ID again. Card image is the next thing we have to choose. we stay with MUT1. MUT1 is the card image for temperature independent isotropic materials. So materials which have the same property in every direction. Yeah. If you open this, for example, you have, for example, MUT9 or MUT9O. And these card images are, for example, for anisotropic or autotropic materials. Yeah. But we stay with MUT1, the temperature independent isotropic material. Yeah. You have E as the so-called E modulus. You see that hypermesh is already suggesting the data for steel. Since we're going to do static analysis, we just need to put in E modulus and Poisson ratio, for example, and then the shear modulus is calculated automatically by the solver. I also told you that we are going to calculate eigenmodes and eigenfrequencies. And because of that, we need this density also defined to give our part a mass. Because without mass, you cannot have a frequency. And that's it, basically, with material definition for now. You can click on Klaus. And to link the material which we have created, you can find it even here in the model browser, or if you double click on material, the material browser will open and you see that, and you have all the properties of this material in, you see all the properties of this material in one shot. So the name, ID, the type is isotropic and the card image MUT1, yeah? And you can do this with everything here. You can click here, double click on components to be in the component browser. And if you don't want to see the component browser anymore, you can just click here on this X for close. So we have materials and MUT steel. If you also click highlight it, you can also view the properties of this material and change properties in this entity browser. But now we need to find a way to connect this material steel to our component tetraeder. And this connection is done in Hypermesh via properties. So we have to create a property. If we go to this model menu to properties, we can create a property. Let's create a prop. Mounting system. You can give this property color again, and then what's important now is this card image. Yeah, we don't have a P shell because P shell stands for property shell. No, we have a P solid because we have tetraeder elements and these are solid elements. We click on P solid, and now we can select the material. We just click here on material. Click here, material steel, choose it and say, okay. And the rest can be left as it is, yeah? You can click here on escape. And now we just have to connect this property to this mesh or this component. And this is done via this entity browser. You just highlight tetraeder. Go to the entity browser, click here on property and select the recently created property, prop mounting system. If you click on OK, you will see that the material is changed straight away as well. To make sure that this mesh is really, really has this property and this material is signed, you can make use of this measure, but this calculate ribbon, yeah. You can just click here on the small button, and here you can choose, for example, components or elements, and create calculate area, volume, mass, and so on. Yeah, just choose these elements here. Click on compute, and you see that we have a volume of 509,655 cubic millimeters. Yeah, and we have a structural mass of 4 times 10 to the power of minus 3 tons or megagrams. Megagrams, yeah. So tons, yeah. Since we are working in the tons, millimeter seconds unit systems. Perfect, yeah. So our property or mass is linked to this tetraeder component now. What do we have to do now? Now we have to create boundary conditions, forces, and load step to even be able to calculate something. Yeah. To do that, you can go to the analyze menu, and here you can see already we can create loads with this load ribbon. We can create BCs, boundary conditions. Can create, for example, body forces. If I click here, you can see it's acceleration, rotational force, or gravity. Can also define temperature loads. And for now, we are going to use this BC, boundary conditions. Before we use this, I want to show you a new type of elements, the so-called rigid elements. Rigid elements, you can find them here in model RBE2, they are called, yeah. Rigid elements, basically, I just will create one and then I will explain to you what they actually do here. Yeah? I create a new component by just right click here on component and say create RBE2. I turn this my model around and click here then on RBE2. Then you are asked which are dependent nodes and which are independent nodes. I click here on dependent, then right click, select by face. And now I can select, for example, all the nodes inside this this hole here. Yeah? So face is basically selecting all the nodes at the same time. Yeah. With this angle thing, you can select the degrees. So for example, if I just click here, go out again, and click here on right click, select faces again by face, and put the angle to, for example, 5 degrees, then you can see that not all elements are, or not all nodes are going to be selected, yeah? If I click here on 10, you see that more elements are going to be selected. This is basically the angle between two elements in order to, for this tool to select these elements, yeah? So usually 30 is a good degree to select several elements or all elements, yeah? You can click on OK. Then you see what's going to happen. Of course, we are only allowed to do it for one hole. So I just have to deselect the nodes which I have selected down here by clicking shift on my keyboard so that this minus sign appears next to my mouse and then just draw a window. Yeah. And then you can see that the independent node is automatically created by HyperMesh. It's this node here in the middle. So this tool, RBE2, if you select your dependent nodes, automatically creates the middle node of all of these dependent nodes, which is here, yeah, in the middle of the hole. I click here on OK and do the same for the hole down here. Yeah. Right click here, select by face. By face, select this hole here and say OK. Yeah. And with the middle mouse button, I also can accept, yeah. And what is this middle, this independent node and these dependent nodes? What is the meaning of them? So basically, this RBE2 element does the following: if you apply a boundary condition on the master node, on this middle node here, on the independent node, for example, you say, please. U node, please move 5 millimeters in the X direction. Then all the dependent nodes do the same translation or rotation. Yeah. And the same for here, yeah? So this is an easy way of telling many, many, many nodes to do the same what this node is going to do, yeah? And we tell this node here in the middle and this node to not move at all. So we fix these two nodes in all 6 degrees of freedom, 3 translational degrees of freedom and 3 rotational degrees of freedom. To do that, I'm going to create a load collector because similar to elements and geometry, I have to put loads in a specific load collector. To create a load collector, I can just right click here in my model browser, say create load collector. I call it BC for boundary condition. And to create a boundary condition now, I just hit here on analyze, boundary condition and constraints. Then again, this a panel will be opened and here you can create boundary condition on nodes. And here you have all the 6 degrees of freedom. 1, 2, 3, 4 translational degrees of freedom and 4, 5, 6 for rotational degrees of freedom. We want to constrain this node here and this node here in all 6 degrees of freedom and say create. And then if you, for example, go to the transparent mode, you can see this triangle. It's the symbol of constraint. And you can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So all degrees of freedom which are fixed. If you put here, for example, degree of freedom 3, 10 millimeters, this node would move 10 millimeters in the positive z direction if you put 10 millimeters to those 3. Okay, now we have this, and now it would be good to have a load actually acting here, yeah? To do that, I'm going to create a new collector. I call it force. And I leave this panel now and go here to analyze menu again and hit here on the load ribbon. Here you have pressures, moments, and forces, yeah? I'm going to create forces. This is also still in this panel view. I want to create forces on nodes. Click here on one node and click here on nodes and say by phase. Yeah? In the middle of this yellow area, I can click on and then I can say here by phase. Yeah? Then all the nodes inside this hole are going to be selected. Then I want to have a magnitude of, let's say 100 newtons, so I type here 100, and then I have to exit. So I have to choose a direction in which these loads are acting. Yeah, I can choose the Z axis in order that the forces are acting from up to down. Yeah, and I say create. See now they are pointing upwards. You can see here the errors. So this was not right. I have to put a minus in front of the 100. I click here on reject and put a minus in front of 100 and then I say create. Then you can see that all the loads are pointing downwards in vertical direction and have a magnitude of 100 newtons. Yeah. If you don't see this magnitude, or also with the boundary condition, if you don't see the text, you can switch it on or off by using this symbol here. And here, text next to this load symbol. Yeah, you can switch it on and off. Perfect. Now, in order to calculate all of this, we have to. Just a second. So we have to create a load step. The load step basically defines which boundary conditions are acting in this load step. Which loads are acting? What I actually want to calculate? If I want to have static analysis or if I want to have eigenfrequency analysis. This is all saved in a so-called load step. I can create a load step by just hit right click in the model browser and say create, and here you can see load step. Here this load step is created. You can give it a nice name, for example step one, or let's call it step fourth. And you can make this entity browser a bit bigger. Then if you go further, you can see here analysis type. We want to have a linear static analysis. That means we just have the force, the boundary condition, and our stresses are calculated by E modulus times how's it called now? Sigma is E times epsilon, yeah. So strains is E modulus times stress is E modulus times strains, yeah. This is basically linear static. Hooke's law, basically, yeah. Here the first thing is single point constraints are basically boundary conditions. You can click here on load collector and choose boundary conditions, yeah. Then you can click on load and for example select forces, yeah. So now we have our boundary condition, we have the forces, we don't have pretension, for example. If we go down now and have a look, then we find somewhere at the end output, yeah. This output we are going to use to define which result files we actually want to see. You can of course choose everything, but the result files are getting bigger and bigger the more results you want to have later on. So it's good to just choose these results you really want to have a look at later on. Let's say I want to see displacement. Then I want to see SPCF, single point constraint forces, basically reaction forces. And here we can define, for example, two. That means two types of result display. One would be format H3D. H3D is the result file of OptiStruct. And one format should be punch. And punch is a text file in which the reaction forces are written into. Yeah. So we will get the text file out of our simulation where we have the reaction forces in one line and see directly what's happening in our model. Then we also want to see strain and stresses. And for stresses, I want to make use of this location function and say corner. Corner, because we have 3D elements, that means stress is usually calculated in the center of this element. And here it's, if you have a look at this area here, the highest stress will be at the surface, basically. So not in the element center, it would be more at the element edge or nodes here. Yeah? And to get corner data, we have to request it as result, yeah? So from the centroid of this element, we will get the stresses by linear interpolation to the nodes, and then we get stress results at the nodes. Later on in our simulation result file, yeah. So instead of only having center stresses, we will get corner stresses as well as result. And this is basically what we want to have for this static load case. Then I said I also want to have a eigenfrequency subcase. So I'm clicking on subcase create. I call it eigenfrequency. And instead of static analysis, I can choose now normal modes here, yeah. We have to choose the method. For that, we have to create a load step input. So this we can do with create load step inputs. And In Hauptdistrikt, dies Type, we want to have is IRL. This is for Eigenfrequency Requesting. Yeah? We can here define the start frequency, the frequency we want to end, or we can say we want to have, for example, 10, or let's say the first five eigenmodes of this part with these constraints. Yeah, this is what we need this load step input for. Now we can go back to the load step definition and say here method structural and can choose this load step input so that the load step actually knows what we want to calculate. Yeah, we want to have modes, and here I just use let me just see. It's exactly that should be it already. Step input. Exactly, we want the maximum for norm. Yeah. So this is what we still have to define. The load step input, we should put the norm normalization to max. Yeah. And now we have two subcases. Subcase one, if you click here on ID to listed in ID order. Subcase one is false, and subcase two is eigenfrequency. For eigenfrequency, we had to create a load step input to define what we actually want to have. We want the first five eigenmodes, and we want to have normalization maximum. To calculate the whole thing now is you can click here on in this analyze. Menu on this analyze ribbon here on display button, and we can save our calculation in a specific folder. I put it here to calculation and in class should be the name of my model. Then export options. I want to export everything what's in my model. One option is not optimization. We want analysis, and the rest can stay the same. Yeah. But just have a look again. This should be it. And if you hit OptiStruct now, you will see the following. Export complete. And exactly this window will open. And if you have done everything right, OptiStruct will start to calculate. Or to simulate your model, yeah. You can see here iteration, convergence progress, iteration progress, and here you can see the amount of memory allocated for the run. For me, it's 800 megabytes. Depends from model to model and so on. Yeah, this will take a few seconds, but after everything is calculated, we can have a look at results already. You see here end of solver screen output OptiStruct job completed. Yeah, I go back to HyperWorks and open here now a second window next to my HyperMesh window. This looks funny now, but it takes a few seconds until a new window is open. If I click here in this window, you can see that the right angle here is blue. That means we are now working in this window. And here I can see that I'm not working in HyperMesh anymore. I'm working in HyperView now. HyperView is the post-processor of Altair, and HyperView is used to analyze results. Yeah. If I click here on open now, I can open my model. We set in class.fem. Is our model file. .fem is the input file, so the file which has all the information saved from our model. And the results file in this part is H3D. And if I hit on apply now, I see that my results file do not exist in class H3D apply. No, it's working. Yeah? Good. I can make this window big, and then I only have the result file here. Yeah? If you're annoyed by this text here, or if you don't want to see it, you can just go to the model browser and to notes and just put it away. Yeah. Now I just give you a really short introduction into HyperView. Here you can, for example, say you want to see mesh or you just want to see feature lines. Here, the most important thing in Hyperview is basically this contour plot. Here you can say which result type you want to have, if you want to have a look at displacements or the SPC forces, element stresses or element strain. So all the output requests we have set before. For now, I click on displacement. I say components displayed, so all components, and I click on apply. And you see here we have selected subcase one. This was the first subcase. We have a maximum displacement of 2.1 millimeters. If you want to change the legend here, you can go here to legend, say edit legend, and put, for example, instead of scientific fixed, and for example, one precision. Yeah. If you hit on apply, you will see that you only see even numbers now. You can also change the color of the legend, for example, this should be gray. And if you hit on OK, you see that gray means basically no displacement and red is the highest displacement. Yeah. So that means with the load we have defined, our edge here is moving 2.1 millimeter. It's the magnitude. If you want to have a look at the set displacement, you just switch to set here and hit apply. Then you can see that the 2.1 millimeters is in the negative z direction because it's going to be minus. Yeah, just leave it for magnitude at the moment. And if you want to see the deformation, you can just click here on deformation and say, for example, 10. And then you can see how this part is bent, how this part bends. Yeah, zero. Yeah, then. Instead of only looking at displacement, you can also look at element stresses. And this, like we said before, we want to have corner data because we are interested in these stresses here at the surface and not only in the centroid stresses. So I can put corner data, components displayed. And if I click on apply, you will see the following. Yeah? And maybe we can use the averaging method of simple. This just does, this takes the nodes of each element of neighbor elements, for example, one element here, if they share the same nodes, the stress value at these nodes is, Hyperview calculates an average out of these two stress values. Yeah. If you click on apply, you get a picture like this. Yeah. This is now von Mises stress. So you see, of course, only positive stress values, and you can see here maximum stress values is in this radius and in this radius below. Here you also see the difference between the two mesh types we have chosen. Here is the coarse mesh down here, and here is the fine mesh. So the plot looks already better than down here. Yeah. If you want to see what's going on inside, you can make use of the section cut and say, okay, this is the x-axis, and then you can see here what's going on inside of your model. Yeah. If you don't want to see it anymore, you just don't. You just deactivate it, and exactly. And since we are pressing from up to down, we should have tensile stress here and compression stress here. Since we are looking at von Mises stress results, we cannot say which is tension and what is compression yet. So we can just switch from von Mises, for example, to absolute maximum principle, say apply, and then you can see here we have minus 850 and here we have plus 850. So this is how you can get results plus and minus, yeah, with the principal stress values, yeah. And go back to von Mises and maybe to displacement apply. And now I want to show you the second subcase we have calculated is the eigenfrequency. Component displayed and apply, and then you can see here we have eigenmode one with the frequency of this year. One point ten times 1.1 times the power times 10 to the power of minus 2. What's going on there? Apply. Ah, we have forgotten, of course, to put the boundary condition in our load step. That's the reason we have a zero eigenfrequency. This is the translation. Eigenfrequency, we should have put SPC forces. SPC boundary conditions, we should have put this here. Yeah, I'm going to calculate this again. Analyze. Was the wrong button? I want to have display button. Save as in class obdestruct. And yes, yeah, I'm going to calculate it really fast again. So what, how did I see this now? The eigenfrequency is basically zero, and we have five times five eigenmodes calculated, and all of these five eigenmodes have a frequency of basically zero. This is the rigid body rigid body movements. These are all at eigenfrequency zero. So this is just that the part goes, for example, if you have a look at the deformation, for example, 10, 100, that, okay, it's not working now, but basically rigid body movement is, you have three translational rigid body movements and three rotational rigid body movements. So. But I think our calculation is done, and we can have a look at the eigenfrequencies, which how they should be. In class 3D, and this is FEM. So I am going to choose this now, and subcase eigenfrequency, and now you can see that we have five eigenfrequencies which are not zero anymore because we have the constraints here. So if I choose the first one and go to contour, the component display, I can see how this part moves. And if I click here on display button, for example, or if I choose here this model thing, click here on play and here on speed. I can see how much the frequency is working. Can put the deformation a bit higher, for example, to 5, and I can see how I can see my eigenmode, the shape of my eigenmode. Yeah. Example, for example, like this. This is the first eigenmode at 775 hertz. Second eigenmode is in this direction. Can again make this higher, or even 25. And maybe a bit slower. And for example, this one is then the third eigenmode. Here is the sixth eigenmode. This is already this bending again. And then we have this eigenmode is this one here, yeah. So you have seen if you don't set boundary conditions, you will get the first six eigenmodes should be zero then, or nearly to zero, because this is the rigid body motion. Yeah. If you apply boundary conditions to your model, you don't have rigid body motion anymore because your part cannot rotate or translate anymore. That's the reason you get then the real eigenfrequencies, I would say, the first mode, the second mode, and the first eigenfrequency and the second eigenfrequency and so on, yeah. And why is this important? If you are designing parts and for example, you design a part for a car and you drive it this car and you have external forces which are reacting, reactivating, which are activating this eigenmode, for example, because you drive on a street which is not straight, and then you have a force, for example, acting like this. And if you hit the eigenfrequency of this part, then you have resonance problems. Yeah, that's why I wanted to show you this eigenfrequency subcase as well. Yeah, so I hope you have a good you got a good insight into hypermesh and OptiStruct. Yeah, if you have any questions, just ask them. Thank you very much.